and other European countries to discover mysterious cases involving the sighting of strange objects and phenomena which have appeared in the skies since antiquity. Great authors of the past have recorded celestial events in their works, including incidents with airborne craft, as in the case of Roman historian Titus Livius, who described flying objects in the sky, shaped like circular shields. The same is true of Roman writer Pliny the Elder, who refers to fiery shields flying the skies over Rome, in the 1st century AD, or Flavius Josephus, who discusses an amazing phenomenon in Judea, involving several chariots and armed troops floating in midair. Yet, 4th-century Roman writer Julius Obsequens left one of the best records in his Book of Prodigies, which discusses the strange and inexplicable celestial phenomena that took place during the Roman Empire, as we will soon see in this interesting and revelatory fourth episode. The long history of unidentified flying object sightings also involves cases of contactees and other people who had direct contact with beings from stellar space who use interdimensional portals to reach this planet with the aim of warning us and helping us through our evolutionary process. Regrettably, however, to date, we have not paid attention to their precious help. Had we heeded them, our circumstances would be very different from. Indeed, these publications are professionally prepared with rigorous accuracy and transparency and broadcast periodically throughout the world. We would also like to offer our thanks and congratulations to the many who are accompanying us in this noble endeavor. They do so with cordiality and sincerity through their efforts to make our documentaries. We have published a total of 19,964 video documentaries ranging from Alcyon Pleiades documentaries, video specials, and recommended videos. They have been translated into 10 languages, namely, English, German, French, Spanish, Portuguese, Italian, Japanese, Russian, Greek, and Dutch, and are produced with the sole aim of making them available to as many people as possible, worldwide. We would also like to mention that they have been published in 227 countries across the world's 5 continents, which Alcyon Pleiades has been able to reach. And its many clear messages and well-documented news have been made available to inquiring viewers to alert the public about what is taking place. However, the whole of humanity is facing a critical situation because the governments of many. We have boosted our publications with short recommended videos in order to disclose information by expert scientists. And skilled professionals, including toxicologists, biochemists, microbiologists, virologists, and geneticists. In addition, we share information from recognized journalists and activists, cinema producers, famous physicians and cardiologists, as well as top lawyers, and writers. As well as members of Parliament or Congress, including senators and many other professionals who are fighting to turn the situation around by providing true information. Moreover, we produce our specials, single theme videos to warn people and expose what is being plotted against humanity. Our aim is to shine the light of truth and to expose reality as we help all those of pure and noble heart who yearn for awakening so that they will know what has been hidden from us for centuries with all the deception and harm perpetrated against humanity. Because of all these factors, we would like to extend our deepest thanks on this happy 11th anniversary to those who create the blueprint and guidelines behind these insightful and interesting documentaries for their tireless dedication and day-to-day efforts. We are referring to a skilled team working in production, editing, writing, revision, translation, and voice for all 10 languages in which we periodically publish. With great professionalism and effort, everyone works together to carry out their noble and unstoppable work. Because the whole team is certain that we're living very difficult times, and anything that contributes to the common good is held in very high regard by the beings of light, who know the real reason we are doing all of this. As part of this selfless and valued effort, we hope that, with the help of Divinity, who sees everything, we will be able to overturn the difficult situation we are living and continue with this great social and human endeavor in our urgent awakening to the truth. We would also like to thank our faithful viewers and subscribers who await each new publication with enthusiasm, seeking support, so that they will be able to understand and apply the knowledge received. By the same token, we'd also like to thank all those who, in one way or another, have collaborated with us over the course of these 11 years to ensure this selfless project for the good of humanity moves forward. We hope that all those accompanying us in this crusade of light, under the banner of truth and justice, will continue expressing the called to very clearly define whether we will shift towards the light of the truth, charity, intelligence and love, or move in the opposite direction, towards the darkness of slavery, zombification, and rampant robotism. However, every person has the complete freedom to choose what they consider best. As far as we are concerned, we will do everything possible to selflessly help those accompanying us with goodwill, persistence, and a yearning for self-improvement. Based on their internal aspirations, evolution and love for others, our viewers should continue to support people who are in pain. This will help alleviate the terrible karma of suffering and consternation that humanity is enduring. Humanity's past is filled with evidence of UFOs, from ancient Egypt to Asia and Europe. They are even found in Native American myths or in art from the Renaissance period. This is evidence that we have been visited by spaceships from other worlds since the dawn of humanity. As far as amazing manifestations and phenomena are concerned, we'd like to point to the Tully Papyrus. This well-known case is a mysterious text that some researchers describe as the first written account of a UFO sighting. What is most striking about this Egyptian text is that it describes an event that took place during the 18th dynasty, around 1440 before Christ. It discusses a spectacular UFO sighting in ancient Egypt, during the reign of Pharaoh Thutmose III. Among available evidence, we also know of strange and inexplicable phenomena that occurred during the Roman Empire, which were recorded in the Book of Prodigies by Roman writer Julius Obsequens, who lived in the 4th century. These incidents are also referenced in more historical sources containing testimonies from other countries. For instance, the book, The Chronicles of the Kings of Judah, contains a description of several nights in which fiery star-shaped objects flew over their cities. These incidents occurred in 839 BC. We must also not forget that the first event recounted by Julius Subsequens, in his Liber Prodigiorum, refers to the sudden and mysterious disappearance of Romulus, the founder and patriarch of Rome, which is also associated with certain UFO episodes. Romulus was holding a meeting with his soldiers when a storm broke out unexpectedly, with great thunder and lightning. It engulfed the king in a cloud so dense that it removed him from the assembly's sight, never to appear on earth again. Similarly, in 500 BC, during the second consulate of Roman military officials Publius Postumius Tubertus, and the first consulate of Agrippa Menenius Lenatus, flaming war spears were seen in the sky, until very late at night. Furthermore, the Greek philosopher Anaxagoras, who lived in the 5th century BC, saw an object in the sky, the size of a large log, which remained immobile for several days, emitting an unusual glow. In his Anabasis, the Athenian historian and philosopher Xenophon, who lived between the 5th and 4th centuries BC, classifies the flying object sighted based on their shape. He described them as shell-like, flat, flared, and triangular. In 221 BC, when Gaius Quintius Flaminius and Publius Furius Philus were Roman consuls, the late night sky in Rimini became as bright as day, and three moons appeared in different parts of the firmament. By the same token, in 217 BC, the inhabitants of Rome saw two shining shields of polished bronze, soaring through the skies. On the same day, in the eastern part of the city, numerous people claimed they saw beings that looked like humans, dressed in radiant white. Moreover, in 215 BC, under the consuls Gnaeus Servilius Geminus and Gaius Quinctius Flamininus, citizens in Rome sighted the apparition of ships in the firmament. A shield was seen in the sky, in the southern Italian city of Arpi, and there was combat between the moon and the sun. Additionally, two moons rose there, during the day. In Capua, Italy, citizens saw the firmament go up in flames, and observed ships appear in the sky. Something similar happened in Adria, a northern Italian city in the Veneto region, in 214 BC. During the fourth consulate of Quintus Fabius Maximus Verrucosus and the third of Marcus Claudius Marcellus, both Roman officials, an altar was seen in the sky, with visions of men gathered round it, dressed in white. Furthermore, in 202 BC, in the time of the Roman consuls Marcus Cornelius and Publius Sempronius Tuditanus, two suns were seen in the sky. And during the night, there were flashes of light. That same year, in Cetse, in central Italy, a meteor was observed, which extended from the rising sun before moving westward. In 201 BC, during the consulate of Roman leaders Gnaeus Servilius Caepion and Gnaeus Servilius Geminus, at Anani, in the Italian region of Lazio, intermittent flashes were observed in the sky first, only to be followed by a luminous meteor, which appeared in the firmament. Moreover, in 172 BC, when Roman consuls and military officials Sempronius Paulus and Publius Mutius Scaevola were at the Forum, three suns shone all at once. On that same night, many wandering stars glided across the firmament, in Lanuvium. The following year, in 171 BC, during the consulship of two Romans, Lucius Postumius Albinus and Marcus Popilius Lenas, a large carpenter's square-like object was sighted in the sky repeatedly, in Lanuvium. In 161 BC, during the consulate of Roman officials Tiberius Gracchus and Marcus Juventius, phenomena occurred in several Italian cities. In Capua, the sun was seen at night. In Formia, two suns were observed during the day. And in Pesaurus, a sun of sorts shone during the night. A similar scenario took place in Cassino, in 164 BC, where the sun was visible for several hours at night. Another striking phenomenon took place in 152 BC. In the era of Roman consuls Lucius Opimius and Quintus Postumus, in Conza, where citizens saw weapons in the sky. In 154 BC, more flying saucers appeared. And other sightings took place during the consulate of Roman officials, Publius Africanus and Gaius Livius. In 145 BC, in the Livigno area, Italy, between 8 and 11 o'clock, two circles of different colors, one reddish in hue and the other white, surrounded the sun, and the star twinkled for 32 days. In 138 BC, in Praeneste and Celilonia, in central Italy, banners were seen falling from the sky. To what could this description refer, if not to flying objects descending to Earth? By the same token, one night, 104 years before the Christian era, citizens of two cities in Italy saw spears of fire soaring through the skies, with intelligent movement. In Rimini, in 102 BC, at the time of Roman consuls Gaius Marius and Gaius Flaccus, the moon and the star appeared in broad daylight, from 8 o'clock in the morning to 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Furthermore, Greek writer and philosopher Plutarch reports on how that same year, enormous rays and flaming shields appeared in the sky. At first, they moved separately, only to merge later, despite there being no obvious crash between them. Cigar-shaped objects and discs were amongst these moving forms. It should also be noted that in 100 BC, chronicles mention a very large shield-shaped object traveling through the skies. Similarly, in the territory of Gallia, present-day France, Belgium, Switzerland, and northern Italy, under the consulate of Gaius Marius and Quintus Lutatius, the night was aglow with great brilliance, which lit up the entire camp. The Roman philosopher Seneca, who lived in the 1st century BC, wrote the following in his book Natural Questions. In our era, on bright days, rays of light have been seen more than once, crossing the sky from east to west, or vice versa. The objects described by Posidonius belong in this category: pillars and shields engulfed in flames, as well as other shining objects. These lights in the sky do not only appear at night, but during the day as well, and they are not stars or parts of celestial bodies. Furthermore, in 98 BC, during the consulate of Gaius Marius and Lucius Valerius, a twinkling star was seen at a great distance, in Tarquinium, which plummeted in a dizzying descent. At sunset, a circular object resembling a shield was seen crossing the skies, from west to east. In 91 BC, during the consulate of Gaius Valerius and Marcus Herennius, a flickering flame was observed in the firmament at dawn in Bolsena, in the province of Viterbo, Italy. After becoming concentrated into a single point, the flame exposed a ferruginous-colored opening. According to further descriptions, the sky seemed to open up, and tips of the flame appeared in this aperture. Records from 91 BC also refer to an enormous disk of fire accompanied by a burst. Later, that same day, the people of Spoleto, in Italy, observed a golden ball dancing in the sky, which no one was able to explain. On a related note, in 89 BC, during the consulate of Lucius Martius and Sextus Julius, a fiery globe shone in the north, as dawn broke, accompanied by a great noise in the firmament. In Spoleto, a golden globe of fire plummeted, rolling to earth. It appeared to be heading towards the ground, in the east, growing in size, until its volume hid the sun. The second sighting that Plutarch describes took place in 73 BC. Not far from Dardanelles, where the troops of Roman commander Lucullus and King Mithridates of the Bosporus were preparing to engage in battle, when suddenly, the heavens opened, and a barrel-like body of fire appeared and moved quickly, filling the space between the two armies. Another unusual phenomenon took place in 61 BC, when a flaming beam stretched across the western sky. Roman historian Gaius Suetonius also reports that on January 1, in 49 BC, the Roman Emperor Julius Caesar encountered a superhuman figure along the Rubicon River, just as he was called to make a difficult decision. According to Suetonius's account, Caesar had doubts about what to do when a very tall man of extraordinary beauty, who had unquestionably been sent by the gods, appeared. He stole a soldier's trumpet and played it forcefully before crossing to the other bank. This event caused Caesar to decide to cross the river. His decision was guided by divine will and the iniquity of his enemies. After that, he placed his fate in the hands of fortune, with a phrase that went down in history: Alea jacta est. The die is cast. In the year 44 BC, Roman writer and orator Cicero spoke of globes in the sky in chapter 43 of his De Divinatione. He describes the sun shining at night and with great noise in the sky. The heavens seemed to burst and amazing spheres appeared there. Likewise, one of the greatest historians of Roman antiquity, the Frenchman Jerome Carcapino, who died in 1970, describes an event that occurred in the month of July, following Caesar's assassination, in 44 BC. For 7 consecutive days, before dusk, a luminous UFO, which came from the north, was seen over Rome. Also in Rome, in the year 43 BC, a spectacle of missile-like fireworks could be seen on the horizon. In the year 42 BC, during the consulate of Mark Antony and Publius Dolabella, it is said that Gaius Octavius joined the Julian family, by the will of his father, Caesar, in Brindisi. He, the future Emperor Octavian Augustus, entered Rome at 8 in the morning, accompanied by the huge crowd that gathered round him. The sky was a serene blue, and the sun, circumscribed by a small disk, encircled him in a faintly contoured halo, just as rainbows usually sit above the clouds. At this moment, a light was seen in the firmament, which was traveling westward. Like a luminous star, it twinkled with a special glow for 7 days. It should also be noted that 3 suns shone, and the lowest sun was encircled by a glowing crown, similar to a ring-shaped wheat stalk. Later, the sun was reduced to a mere halo, and for many months, its soft light seemed to announce what would become the Roman Empire's longest and most prosperous reign. Two years later, in 40 BC, during the government of Marcus Lepidus and Minatius Plancus, in Modena, 3 suns were seen at 8 o'clock in the morning, which later merged into a single disk. Likewise, in 32 BC, in Amiternum, they saw the sun shine at night and observed its splendor for some time. Something similar happened in 25 BC, as a celestial splendor extended from the south to the north, lighting up the night, as if it were daytime. By the same token, in 14 AD, in the history of Rome, Latin historian Titus Livius provides evidence of circular shield-shaped objects that soared through the skies and were seen in numerous cities across the empire. The author also adds that the second king of Rome, Numa Pompilius, personally witnessed one of these flying shields falling from the sky. Additionally, Roman scientist Pliny the Elder, who lived in the 1st century AD, discusses Clypeus Ardens, the burning shield seen in the skies of ancient Rome. He also reports on the sighting of lights in the sky, along with torches, fireballs, and flying rays, similar to those appearing in ancient Greece. In 65 AD, historian Flavius Josephus wrote about a strange phenomenon in Judea as follows. On the 21st day of the month of Artemisia, a marvelous sight appeared there. What I am saying might seem like fiction, were it not for the accounts of witnesses and the disasters that followed, which deserve to be recounted. Before sunset, chariots and an armed army could be seen in the air, in all parts of the country, rushing noisily through the clouds and surrounding the cities. Another incident happened to the brother of Pope Pius I, who was likely the sole witness of a UFO that appeared near the Via Campania in Italy, in 150 AD. On a sunny day, a ceramic-like monster, about 30 meters in diameter, appeared. Multicolored at the top and shooting firebolts, it landed in a cloud of dust, accompanied by a maiden dressed in white. Similarly, in 150 AD, there were reports of the landing of what was likely a spaceship. This incident occurred on the main road from Rome to Capua. According to chronicles, a huge curved object, 100 meters long, appeared in the sky one sunny day and descended to Earth. The upper part of the object was multicolored, and it shot out burning rays of light. An occupant emerged from the object, who looked like a maiden dressed in white. In 196 AD, Cassius Dio, a Roman consul and historian of Greek descent, wrote, "A fine silver rain descended from the sky over the Forum of Augustus. I did not see it fall, but I noticed it later. Using it, I coated several bronze coins with silver. They kept their appearance for several days. But on the fourth day, the substance applied to them disappeared." As we continue our discussion of UFO sightings in antiquity, we will describe a wide variety of incidents that are also recorded in different historical texts. In 312 AD, Constantine the Great, the first Christian emperor, and his entire army contemplated a glowing cross in the sky. And it is said that they achieved victory over Maxentius after a huge unidentified flying object shaped like a sword appeared over his troops. Furthermore, in England, the Benedictine monk Bede, in his Ecclesiastical History, states that in 664 AD, a luminous flying sheet appeared over the heads of the nuns of Barking Abbey, by the Thames. In an ancient book, the Capitularies of Charlemagne, by the 8th century emperor, it is said that the people flying in these aircraft were upset to see the terror they caused by descending to Earth. He refers to huge flying vehicles, whose occupants decided to invite men and women onto the craft, to teach them their customs, before bringing the people back to Earth, to report on what they saw. Similarly, in 776, in the middle of a battle between the Saxons and the Franks, in Sigiberg, Germany, something appeared in the skies. Witnesses saw two flaming shields in midair, one after the other. Another incident took place in the city of Lyon, France, in the 9th century, when three men and one woman emerged from an airborne ship. The entire population gathered round, anxious to see them, and the crew tried to prove they were actually French citizens who had been whisked away by wonderful men, who showed them marvels, so that later, they could tell their fellow citizens about them. But the ship's occupants had no luck, because the populace rejected them. Continuing our investigation into these sightings, in 919 AD, an object that looked like an inflamed torch was sighted in the sky, and balls as shiny as the stars soared through the air, over Hungary. In 1118, in France, a cross and a moon with glimmering white rays appeared in the sky, and everyone believed that the end of the world was imminent. Something similar happened in 1150. A cross was seen in the skies of England at midday, when King Richard the Lionheart and Philip of France were preparing for battle against Saladin, the Saracen Emperor. One ancient account says that on the 24th of July, 1239, in France, a huge star that looked like a torch appeared. It rose from the south and flew from side to side, emitting a powerful light in the sky, until it changed direction and headed north, without hurry or any kind of speed, as if it wanted to rise. But when it appeared in the middle of the firmament, it left smoke and sparks in its wake and disappeared. The Chronicle of English historian William of Newburgh, in Yorkshire, England, contains the following description. The abbot and monks were eating, when a flat, round, shiny, silvery object flew over the abbey. This event happened in 1290. Also, the French Duke of Burgundy wrote the following in his memoirs. An object appeared in the sky over France on the night of November 1, 1461. It was as long and wide as a crescent moon. It remained motionless and clearly visible for about a quarter of an hour. And then, suddenly, it spiraled, twisted and turned like a spring, and rose up towards the sky. In the work, Prodigiorum ac Ostentorum Chronicon, printed in Basel in 1557, Alsatian humanist and encyclopedist Conrad Lycosthenes describes the sighting of strange objects that soared through the skies during the Middle Ages and Renaissance. In addition to providing descriptions of Greek and Christian crosses, the book recounts the passage of an object, which the author calls a ray, through the skies of Arabia in 1479. His reporting of the event is published alongside a drawing of this so-called ray, which is incredibly like a modern-day missile. Another celestial event occurred in the 16th century. Benvenuto Cellini, an Italian goldsmith and sculptor, at the Medici's service, describes a strange phenomenon in his autobiography, which he witnessed personally, in the company of a travel companion. The two were returning from Rome to Florence, on horseback, when they reached a hill from which the city was visible. It was there they saw a luminous beam over the skies of Florence. In December of 1517, near Verdello, in the province of Bergamo, Italy, two armies were seen engaged in battle, which lasted an hour, before the entire scene disappeared. This apparition repeated itself for 8 consecutive days, until it finally disappeared completely. However, the hoofprints of numerous horses and damaged trees were found at the site of the fictitious battle. Is it possible to think that a hologram was projected onto the place and replayed several times? In 1520, in England, a great ray of fire was seen in the sky over Hereford. Nearing the ground, it burnt many things, with the heat it radiated. Then, it ascended into the sky once more, and was seen changing shape, until it morphed into a circle of fire. The flying saucers found in the skies of a tapestry, entitled The Summer's Triumph, are unmistakable. This tapestry, woven in 1538, in Bruges, Belgium, is preserved in the Bavarian National Museum, in Munich, Germany. It depicts a ruler's victorious rise to power, surrounded by cheering crowds. Yet, there are figures in the sky that cannot be clouds. In fact, they look more like extraterrestrial ships. In 1544, an important UFO-related event occurred, according to a news report found in a famed Wikiana collection at Zurich Central Library. This collection of medieval and Renaissance chronicles was compiled by Johann Jakob Wick, a Swiss clergyman from the 16th century. One account reads as follows: in the year 1544, signs were seen on the sun and the moon, causing people to fear that God might punish the earth for their sins. The appearance of these wondrous signs in the sky was preceded by an earthquake. On May 4th, also in 1544, between 4 and 5 o'clock in the morning, numerous peasants from villages in the Pforzheim area, in Germany, observed a so-called star, with a long tail the size of a millstone, emitting sparks. Also, very early in the morning, on April 4th, 1561, residents of the city of Nuremberg, in what is today Germany, saw what they described as an air battle between strange flying objects floating through the sky. The Nuremberg Gazette reported the event in its April 14th issue of 1561. An original copy of the edition is archived in the Wikiana collection of engravings and drawings at Zurich Central Library in Switzerland. The newspaper describes a battle between objects of various shapes, including high-speed flying crosses, globes, and cigar-shaped tubes, which opened up to release other spherical objects that swept across the sky, followed by two crescent-shaped objects, and finally, a huge black triangle, similar to the tip of a spear. The phenomenon lasted approximately 1 hour, after which the objects began to burn and fall to the ground, where they evaporated and disappeared, before the astonished gaze of hundreds of onlookers. The same thing happened on July 8, 1566, when spheres were seen soaring over Basel, Switzerland, where numerous spherical objects, in light and dark colors, appeared. The objects faced off against each other, in some kind of aerial combat, before the upturned gaze of the city's inhabitants, who watched the skies, observing the scene. Another interesting episode that took place in Naupactia, Greece, is found amongst the writings of Father Alberto Guglielmotti, official historian of the Pontifical Navy, who tells us that the night before September 21, 1571, the skies were cloudless and the stars clear and bright. A column-like flame of fire hovered in midair for a long time. It was large enough and bright enough to be seen by everyone who gazed at the sight with great wonder. Spanish historian Jeroni Pajades tells us about his day-to-day activities while working as a judge and proxy for the Count of Empúries in his work entitled Dietari. Real and unexplained phenomena come together on a single page of his diary, as he relays a series of events associated with the UFO phenomenon, which happened on September 30, 1604, during a battle in the skies of Catalonia. Next, we have Parisian publisher Pierre Menier, in Discourses of the Terrible and Fearsome Signs That Appeared Over the Sea of Genoa. He recounts the following. At the beginning of August, in 1608, portentous traces of blood were falling from the sky, in the form of rain, on the side of Nice, and in various places in Provence. Then, there was the apparition of two men, who beat each other, multiple times, hovering in midair, over the island of Martigues, which is a village on the sea, 5 leagues from Marseille. Events very similar to the ones Menier describes, also happened that same day, in the nearby country of Italy, in the city of Genoa, where a battle in the skies was waged over the Genovese port. Next, we have the case of a huge flying torpedo that released colorful rays, which was seen by Prefect Christopher Ascheri near the city of Fluelen, in Switzerland, in 1619. And a curious circular object is found on a French coin, called a jeton, that was minted between 1656 and 1680. For US researcher Scott C. Waring, this image is absolute proof that, in the 17th century, the French witnessed enough UFO sightings to decide to put some of what they saw on a coin. It is about the size of a US quarter dollar and appears to commemorate a UFO sighting of a wheel-like object. According to the Daily Mail, a comparable token from 1648 also depicts a circular object similar to the one Waring shows on his website. In that case as well, it is considered to be, most likely, a UFO. Another phenomenon took place in 1660, namely, a sighting by two French ships, in the North Sea, between Norway and Denmark, which reported an object flying slowly through the sky. It seemed to be made of two discs of different sizes. An account of this event is relayed in a book called Theatrum Orbis Terrarum, written in 1665, by French Admiral Bleu. An event similar to the sighting of Nuremberg took place 100 years later, in England. Indeed, on June 29, 1661, an incident occurred whose characteristics were highly analogous to those typifying the aerial phenomena of the Battle of Nuremberg. The sighting of a luminous globe is recounted in Chronicles of the Kirillo-Belarusky Monastery, near Robozero, known today as Vologda, in western Russia, close to Beloye, or the White Lake. On the morning of August 15, in 1663, in the area of the lake closest to the monastery, many witnesses could see this celestial phenomenon, including the monks and fishermen fishing in Lake Beloye, as well as some townspeople. On August 4, 1665, six fishermen from the German city of Stralsund, in the Baltic, were witnesses to a battle in the clouds. It was 2 in the afternoon when these six fishermen saw a mass of ships appear, in broad daylight, with billowing sails, arriving first from the north, and then, from the south. The fishermen realized that they were vast warships, engaged in battle in the skies. Later that afternoon, the two fleets disappeared. Later that afternoon, the two fleets disappeared. On November 4, 1697, according to chronicles of the time, two incandescent wheels emitting rays of light in their surroundings, flew slowly over the city of Hamburg and other places in northeastern Germany. And on December 9, 1731, in Sheffield, England, Thomas Short described the following event. Beneath a dark red cloud was a luminous body which emitted intense beams of light. These luminous beams moved slowly for a while, and then stopped. Suddenly, it became so hot that I could take off my shirt, even though I was out of doors. A similar object appeared on that same day over Romania. Ancient manuscripts described it in these terms. There appeared in the west, a great sign in the sky, blood red and very large. It stayed in place for 2 hours, separated into two parts, which then rejoined, and the object disappeared towards the west. It should also be noted that in 1731, several strange luminous globes flew over the Italian city of Florence on December 9th that didn't look like any known craft. Likewise, in 1762, in the city of Basel, Switzerland, a huge cigar-shaped object surrounded by a luminous ring slowly crossed the solar disk, and the phenomenon was observed by a number of local astronomers. Similarly, in Italy, during an eruption of Vesuvius in 1794, a miracle occurred which everyone saw. It was an extraordinary sign in the skies. A dark pyramid was seen in the air, with four suns and a warrior army. Shortly thereafter, it split into large flames and a number of smaller flames, and immediately threw fiery arrows before it. Also on March 19, 1847, in Holloway, a district of London, in England, a sphere was sighted rising vertically, until it got lost in the clouds. Another mysterious event, also in England, took place on September 4, 1851, during the Great Exhibition, celebrated in Hyde Park, London. Several luminous discs appeared in the skies, from the north. It seemed like someone from above was eager to contemplate what was happening in the English park. Another case was published in the Australian newspaper, the Adelaide Chronicle, on January 7, 1954. The headline of one of its news articles read as follows: "He saw the first flying saucer in 100 years. In the report, Australian journalist Robert E. Walters disclosed the experience an Austrian geography professor called Carl Schneider had on June 23, 1851. Schneider and his family went to the Tyrol region, in Austria, to enjoy their summer holidays. One clear, sunny afternoon, while mountain climbing, Schneider heard a sound whose volume continued to get louder, until it became an intense buzz. The professor lifted his eyes to the sky and observed a celestial body, or a ship from the stars, as he explained to a friend by letter. It was silver in color, but not silver. Actually, it was a strange unknown metal that glittered in the sunlight and dazzled my eyes. It was round in shape, but tapered slightly at a certain point. It rose from a dense mist that sometimes looked like ordinary smoke. At times, it looked milky white and sometimes sparkling and yellowish in the sunlight," Schneider told his family when he returned from his climb. Among ancient accounts of the most famous UFO sightings, we find those involving Vimanas, as these flying objects were known, in ancient India. Detailed descriptions of them are found in ancient books, which discuss their technique, as well as their use. The musical sounds of ancient Hindus' Vimanas were not always thunderous, nor did they always have terrible and destructive consequences, as was the case in ancient wars recorded throughout history. On the contrary, when Vimanas traveled through the skies in times of peace, they emitted a sound, as they passed, which was truly melodious. This harmonious effect has also been observed with other UFOs. For instance, on August 12, 1950, several people were out walking in the outskirts of the town of Campello, in Switzerland, when they saw and heard something wonderful in the skies. More than 80 objects passed by in a regular formation. However, theirs was not a soundless flight. In fact, as these mysterious flying objects passed, they left delicate music in their wake, as if someone from above were playing a celestial symphony. Three years earlier, on May 22, 1947, a group of strange objects flew over Denmark at a low altitude, leaving behind a melodious sound. These kinds of sounds have not only been heard from the skies. Rather, Norwegian fisherman Olaf Jansen, who visited the inner Earth with his father, said that the beings who inhabit this paradise-like place are extremely sensitive to music. Their cities are endowed with immense palaces of music, where up to 25,000 vigorous voices, belonging to this race of giants, swell in powerful choirs of sublime melodies. Cases like these remind us of the words found in the Hindu Sama Veda, or Book of Hymns. A Vimana can be moved, it says, by the beat of songs and music. Next, we have the case of two Russian men, Alexander Kozhevnikov and Vitaly Kozhenkov, who were photographing sites near a local monument in Borik, in the Russian region of Volga, when suddenly, they saw an object that was 4 to 5 meters in diameter. It was grayish-blue in color. Its hull was slightly shining, and it was covered with a dull thin coating. Their first reaction was to photograph the saucer. The object suddenly began moving, with movements resembling that of a flower blooming, and two beings appeared in the center of the object. They resembled humans and somehow descended to the ground. They approached the witness and got within 3 to 4 meters of him. They moved like normal humans. They had normal human extremities, but were much taller, by 2 heads, at least. Alexander could see their faces clearly, and their bodies appeared to be covered with something like hoarfrost, and they were wearing tricot, flesh-colored, tight-fitting outfits. The figures were slender and slightly fluorescent pink-violet in color. Their hands and fingers glowed pinkish-violet also. The color of their faces was like ordinary humans. However, the glow from their bodies prevented the witness from seeing their faces clearly. Their eyes were set very close to each other, and they had beautiful features in the area of the lips and chin. The witness did not notice any hair. The figures stopped 3 meters from the man, who then heard sounds emanating from the two beings. The sound resembled beautiful music of different tones. They addressed him in a melodic purr. The whole time these beings continued their singing. Their mouths were opening and their lips were moving. Amazingly, the witness found himself answering them, using the same melodic music or tones. The sounds emanated right from his throat, seemingly against his will. He understood that the extraterrestrials were telling him to calm down and not to be afraid. They told him that they came from a place with three stars. The conversation lasted for about 8 to 9 minutes. Then they turned back to the object. The segment closed and vanished. He did not see the UFO take off and heard no sounds. Looking up, he saw the saucer hovering over the forest at an altitude of about 150 meters, and then it just disappeared. The whole time, his friend Vitaly remained in a frozen state. After developing the film, he discovered that all the shots appeared white or overexposed. After the encounter, a sense of calm came over the man, who became more philosophical in his approach to life. There are other close encounters between these cosmic beings and humans, like the one that happened in 1952, when a strange ship landed somewhere in East Germany. A mysterious device emerged from its interior, and two beings in a silvery uniform appeared, who looked a lot like humans. They were seen by a man and his daughter. At first, both of them feared the event was something hostile, and they ran to the authorities to report the event. When the police arrived at the place the UFO had landed, they saw nothing on the grass, except the object's circular print. It had already left, along with its occupants. Additionally, on the afternoon of January 7, 1948, a huge disc appeared in the skies of Madisonville, Kentucky, in the United States, and it was seen by thousands of people throughout the area. The chief of police immediately warned the Fort Knox military base, telling them that a disc, measuring 80 meters in diameter, was heading in that direction. Half an hour later, the disc flew above the Godman Airfield, in the vicinity of Fort Knox, where all of the United States gold reserve is stored. They were quick to follow up on the alarm, and Colonel Guy Hicks, the field commander, ordered Captain Thomas Mantle to approach the disc. Mantle, at that moment, was carrying out a training flight with three other pilots, in a fighter squadron with F-51 Mustangs. He was to get a better look at its features and characteristics. A few minutes later, Mantle communicated with the control tower, saying that he had reached the disc in flight. The thing looks metallic and is of tremendous size. Now, it is starting to rise, Mantle said. The disc was above his craft. The other pilots followed Mantle at a certain distance. However, from that moment onwards, Mantle's radio was deactivated, and the pilot disappeared. The next day, the twisted wreckage of his craft was found 130 kilometers from the airport. The authorities did not allow journalists to see Mantle's body or his plane, and the investigation was kept a secret. In a coastal location in Argentina, in August 1956, Orlando Jorge Feraudi sat on the beach just before midnight. It was then that he heard a noise behind him, and when he looked in that direction, he could see a tall, strange human being watching him. The being was at least 2 meters tall. His skin was very white and his eyes were very light. He had very clean hair, but no facial hair. He was also wearing some kind of tight uniform. The strange being spoke directly to Feraudi's head, telling him not to be afraid. The being also said he wanted Feraudi to join him on a long journey. Soon Feraudi discovered that a strange disc was heading towards them, gliding along the water. It stopped in front of them, and the ramp extended forward. Upon entering, he noticed an adolescent human, who was not one of the strange visitors. The girl said that these beings from the stars were good. She introduced herself as Elena and informed Feraudi that she had been on board for just a short time. They were soon informed telepathically that they would have to change clothes due to strange elements and germs. He was given a uniform to wear and, after Feraudi claimed it was too tight for him, the cosmonaut urged him to put it on. When he placed his legs inside a small hole in the material, it began to expand, to completely cover his body. He said that despite having nothing on his feet, he felt like he was wearing a comfortable pair of shoes. Not long afterwards, the ship plunged into the freezing waters of the Atlantic Ocean and traveled underwater for some time, to avoid radars. They arrived at a short distance from Samborombón Bay, Argentina, where the object emerged from the water. Arriving off the coast of Uruguay, the ship crossed the Atlantic towards Africa. From here, according to Feraudi, the UFO rose and entered outer space. After its off-planet experience, the strange disc returned to Earth and re-entered the ocean. They were in the waters of the Gulf of Mexico. In no time, they realized they were inside a giant underwater dome, where there was an entire city, with tall buildings and extensive activity. As they traveled through this area, one of the beings told them they would pass a test. A tray of strange eggs was brought to them. They were to eat them and to drink a strange, clear and thick liquid. Then, they were each invited to lie down. A U-shaped pillow, with lights around it, was set up. Almost immediately, he and Elena were sound asleep. However, when they woke up, something strange happened. They could read everyone's minds. The most interesting thing was that both were told that their pineal gland had been reactivated. You will be useful to us in the future, because this gland is the only legacy we have left here. Because of the five races that inhabit this planet, none of them originates from Earth. They are just remnants of civilizations from other planets, the stellar being explained. Due to the reactivation of that gland, Feraudi and Elena would experience new sensations. For example, they were told, "When we think about you, you will hear a buzzing in your head." These beings explained that what humans imagine or perceive as God is a form of absolute energy to them. In addition, Feraudi received extensive medical information. The details Feraudi learned were not just ahead of his time, they were at a level that was simply beyond his mental medical capacity. He didn't know how, but he woke up in the same spot where he was taken. The whole experience lasted about 6 hours. In 1959, 79 UFO sightings were reported, which was a very considerable number, previously unheard of, on the island of New Guinea. At 6:45 in the afternoon, on June 26, Australian missionary William Bruce Gill found himself with 37 other people in a cooperative camp when he observed a shining object descending over the mission. Very quickly, all those present were able to observe the phenomenon. It was a circular object with a wide base, from which four tripods emerged. And every once in a while, it emitted a beam of blue light, focused directly towards the sky. Four beings with human characteristics appeared on the mysterious object's deck. and moved around there for 15 minutes, although not all of them were visible at all times. The object stayed beneath the clouds for approximately 1 hour before disappearing among them. 1 hour later, the UFO returned and repositioned itself over the mission. They could see other craft as well, some big, some small, soaring through the skies for more than 2 hours, Reverend Gill explained. On January 30, 1965, Sid Padrick, a 45-year-old man from California, spent 2 hours aboard a spaceship of unknown origins. He was taking a walk on the beach, not far from home, when around 2 in the morning, he claims he suddenly heard a whistling sound, similar to that of a jet plane. In the darkness of the night, he distinguished the outline of a huge craft that was approximately 15 meters in diameter and 10 meters high. The shape of the craft was reminiscent of two upside-down plates stacked against each other. Panicking, Padrick started to run. But he heard a voice coming from the craft. "Don't panic, we are not the enemy." Trying to escape, he heard the voice repeat the message, "We mean you no harm." Then, the same voice invited him to come aboard. Padrick stopped, slowly retraced his steps, saw an open door, and went aboard the ship. The room was about 2 by 2 meters. Another sliding door opened, and Padrick entered the room where a man was waiting for him. "It was amazing how much like us he looked," the witness says. "He wore a tight-fitting suit and spoke perfect English." Padrick had the impression that the craft moved while he was aboard, but he didn't feel any movement. There were 8 men and 1 woman aboard. All of them wore the same light blue suit, but only the man whose voice he had heard talked to him. The man explained that they came from a planet in space, located several light years away. After receiving the promise of another encounter, Padrick disembarked from the ship at 4 o'clock in the morning and returned home. Padrick said that all of them were 1.75 to 1.78 meters tall, more or less, and weighed approximately 68 to 70 kilos. They had short hair, except the woman who wore her hair brushed back, and it disappeared, tucked under her suit. All of them were 20 to 25 years old. They seemed lively, energetic and intelligent. Their hair was brown and their skin, very fair. Their face looked like ours, but was pointier towards the bottom. Their chin and nose were pointed, but their fingers were longer. How did these beings reach our planet, if not through stellar portals allowing them to travel great distances in a short time? What is the aim of contacting and inviting a man to come aboard their high-tech ship, in a peaceful and friendly way? We shall now share the transcript of a report by Brazilian professor João de Freitas Guimarães about his journey in a flying saucer the night of June 16, 1956. Professor Guimarães remembers going to São Sebastião City Hall in the state of São Paulo in Brazil due to his activities as a military lawyer. He found the courthouse already closed and hence went to dinner. Then, as was his custom, he took a stroll along the bay at around 7:15 in the evening. The sky was overcast and gloomy, with no moon. Since he could find no benches, he sat on the sand, with his hands on his knees, and watched the sea, which was very dark. Suddenly, he saw that water becoming lighter, in the strait separating Ilhabela Island and São Sebastião. Later, a spray of water rose, which he thought was a whale. Yet, he quickly understood that it was actually a big-bellied craft heading towards the bay. When the ship arrived, it threw down a kind of anchor, formed by a cable with spheres. Two men leapt out of the craft and began walking towards him. They were two human beings, or at least seemed to be. Guimarães confesses that he felt rather alarmed. He could clearly see that these beings were rather tall, more than 1.75 meters in height, with light skin and beautiful long, blonde hair. They wore green jumpsuits that closed at the wrists, neck, and ankles. Their eyes were light-colored and the gaze, alert. They did not speak any of the languages Guimarães tried using to communicate with them, but, telepathically, they invited him to go aboard the ship. There were three crew members, in all, on the craft, and they took him out of the Earth's atmosphere. Upon their return, he noticed that his watch had stopped, so he is not sure how long the journey lasted, but he believes it took about 30 to 40 minutes. After this long journey, Guimarães went back to his hotel, and felt the desire to talk about his experience with the whole world. He believed that the crews of these ships were carrying out research on the inhabitants of our planet. He had the impression that they wished to warn us about the dangers that threaten humanity. In their view, human conduct is almost savage. Man is born perfectly good, but due to the conditions of his existence, he becomes corrupt. 6 months later, Guimarães spoke about the episode with a São Paulo judge, Dr. Alberto Franco, and with a lawyer in the capital, Dr. Nilsson, who gave complete credence to his experience. Arthur Ernest Bryant, from Scoriton, in the English county of Devon, is one of those men with a story to tell. He claimed that on April 24, 1965, a huge object that looked like a saucer appeared to him, floating 1 meter above ground, in a field next to his house. A door in the saucer opened to reveal three figures dressed in what looked like diving suits and helmets. Bryant claims that one of the three made a sign with both arms extended and moved closer to the UFO. As I approached, Bryant said, they began to take off their helmets, and I looked at them in amazement. Two of them had extremely high foreheads. Their features were thin, greenish-yellow, and they had no facial hair. Their eyebrows and eyelashes were light and thin, and their hair, longer than ours, was blonde. Their noses were stubby and their eyes were very blue. The third person had a normal appearance, there was nothing to distinguish him from you or me. He had short brown hair, very dark brown eyes and appeared to be a young man between 14 and 15 years of age. All three were wearing silvery suits. Bryant claimed that the youth looked like the leader of the group, and when asked about the trio's origins, the being responded, "We are from Venus." Bryant said they invited him into the ship to have a look at it. There was no furniture in it anywhere, except a kind of sofa and a television-type screen with multicolored lights. Bryant saw these extraterrestrial beings for the last time, after he left the spaceship. They had already put their helmets back on, and were standing at the door, waving goodbye with their hands. After that, the door closed, and the UFO ascended to an altitude of 4 meters and disappeared. Next, we have the case of a letter received by João Martins, a Brazilian researcher who wrote about UFOs in the magazine O Cruzeiro. On May 14, 1958, he shared the following case in Brazil. "My name is Anásia Maria, I am 37 years old, and currently live in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Until December 1957, I worked for MX, my former employer. His daughter had stomach cancer. She was suffering terribly, and I was hired as housekeeper, above all, to take care of the young girl, Miss Lice. She had undergone all kinds of treatments, but the doctors said there was no hope. In August 1957, my employer took the whole family to a small farm he owned near Petrópolis, hoping the good weather would help his daughter get better. But the days went by, and there was no change. She could not eat, the pain was unbearable, and she had to be constantly injected with morphine. On the night of October 25th, Miss Lise was suffering atrociously, the injections had no effect, and we thought she was going to die. Suddenly, there was a powerful light, coming from the right side of the farmhouse. It was extremely bright all of a sudden, as if a spotlight was being directed into the room. My employer's son ran to the window and saw the saucer. It was not very big and the top was surrounded by a reddish halo. A kind of automatic panel opened abruptly, and two small figures descended. They came towards the house, while another stood in the doorway of the craft. The two beings entered the house. They were about 1.2 meters tall. Their blonde hair was long and reached their shoulders. Their eyes were small and slanted, like those of the Asians, but of a very intense green. The beings approached Lise's bed, and began by illuminating the young woman's belly with a small instrument. This operation took half an hour. Before leaving, the beings gave her a medicine to take for a month. Miss Lise was cured well before the month was up, and the doctor at the hospital confirmed that the cancer had disappeared. All they used was an instrument similar to a pocket torch, emitting rays that eliminated the cancer, thereby saving the girl. These beings have done many similar things to the people of our planet, to prove that we should not fear them. After saving the young woman that night, they returned to the saucer and left for good. In the small American town of Socorro, New Mexico, on April 24, 1964, an ovoid object with a metallic surface was sighted gliding through the sky, above a street, at around 5 o'clock in the afternoon. Several people nearby were able to watch from their car, as it descended behind a hill. A police officer was on the scene, following another vehicle in his car, at a high speed. When he observed the spaceship falling very close to a dynamite warehouse, he decided to stop chasing the car he was following. At the end of the day, it was just a question of issuing a speeding ticket. When the police officer was about 150 meters from the place where the object had landed, he realized it was not a car at all, but an ovoid vehicle, set up horizontally, and equipped with landing gear and legs. He was able to make out two humanoid figures near him, who were wearing tight-fitting suits. They were small in stature, as if children. They were small in stature, as if children. While he watched these beings, a rumbling noise resumed, at that moment, and grew increasingly loud. Frightened, the officer ran to his car, fearing that the object might explode, and as he turned back, he saw that it had risen from the ground, emitting a bluish flame from its tail. It flew away swiftly, into the sky, in a southwesterly direction, without noise or flames. This next case involves a contactee who saw a luminous fireball soar through the sky, in the direction of the Mount Etna volcano, in Italy. According to his account, he chased it, as well as he could, in his small car, until he suddenly saw a glow, from approximately 100 meters away, which hovered about 5 meters from the ground. When he got out the car, the saucer descended a few meters more. Two cosmonauts came down a small staircase. The one with a diving mask was about 1.90 meters tall, and the other, whose face was uncovered, was blonde, with long hair and extraordinarily beautiful features. They approached him and the group had a friendly conversation. The two beings answered the man's questions and then returned to the cosmic ship, through whose windows he could see other beings greeting him, waving their hands. The saucer rose vertically and at an astonishing speed. In a matter of seconds, it was just another star in the celestial vault. There is also the case of Valiant Thor. In the winter of 1957, Harley Andrew Byrd, nephew of the late Rear Admiral Richard E. Byrd, who was a high-ranking official at the Pentagon, in Washington, D.C., and part of the Blue Book Project, with maximum security clearance, recounts having received a call from the police department in Alexandria, in the U.S. state of Virginia. According to his account, two police officers reported having seen a UFO land in a field. A man dressed in blue emerged, saying that he formed part of the High Council, and that his name was Valiant Thor. This man was picked up and taken to the Pentagon, where he was introduced to the Under Secretary of Defense and U.S. President Dwight D. Eisenhower, and to Richard Nixon, as well, who was Vice President at the time. According to Harley Byrd's claims, Valiant Thor was from Venus, and spent a good amount of time at the Pentagon, talking to the President about the world's problems, in order to offer him help and advice, since he and his people were concerned, particularly about the atomic bombs used in World War II, and sought to begin a new era of knowledge, wisdom, and understanding on our planet. He also explained that his race lived underground, and that many planets throughout the entire universe sustained life in that very same way. Family members close to Eisenhower, including his granddaughter, Laura Eisenhower, also vouched for the fact that Valiant Thor was an extraterrestrial, and that his story was real. Next, there is the surprising episode experienced by Salvador Villanueva Medina, a Mexican citizen. Thanks to his humble simplicity, he had the incredible experience of traveling to the planet Venus, by invitation of a group of small Venusian men. Villanueva Medina recounted his experience in a literary work, entitled, I Was on the Planet Venus, which was published in several languages. Although he had no experience in these kinds of activities, he gave lectures, in which he talked about what happened to him, which is particularly interesting, due to his account's simplicity and the range of details he provides, as he recounts the 5 days he spent on Venus. These small Venusian men showed him their advanced civilization and way of life on a planet with a single nation. We also have the case of US contactee George Adamski, one of the most famous ever. He presented countless UFO photographs taken in the 1940s. Furthermore, he was the first to relay his experiences publicly, recounting how, in 1952, he engaged in communication with a being from the planet Venus in the California desert. This being gave him a message to stop the use of nuclear weapons in order to avoid destruction of the planet. Despite Adamski being faithful to his story until his death, and giving numerous conferences on the topic, many scientists tried to discredit him. Also worthy of note is famous Costa Rican researcher Enrique Castillo Rincon, who recounts hearing a noise while standing at the edge of a lake in 1973. The place lit up for a fraction of a second as he watched two huge ships appear in the sky. Two beings descended from the craft and approached him. Despite being afraid, he explains how he heard a voice asking him to stay calm before he was taken by the hand and invited to go aboard their ship. These beings communicated with him telepathically, and he underwent a process whereby his body was cleaned. Both individuals had blonde hair, light eyes, and a delicate nose and mouth. These tall people were beings from the Pleiades, and they shared incredible knowledge with Castillo Rincon over the course of several years, warning him about the problems threatening the planet. Similarly, we have the case of US inventor and aviator George Van Tassel, who had several extraterrestrial contacts in California's Mojave Desert, in the United States. According to his account, they occurred in August 1953. While in that location, he sighted a ship that remained suspended 3 meters above his head. Extraterrestrials from Venus invited Van Tassel to enter their spaceship via an anti-gravity beam. While visiting the ship, Van Tassel received instructions on how to build a machine that could rejuvenate human cells using natural energy found in the atmosphere. It was a device he called Integratron. Van Tassel financed the construction of Integratron, organizing UFO space conventions for 23 years in Giant Rock on the California border, which thousands attended. Moreover, he was invited to speak at numerous universities throughout the country, lecturing on a new science. He also wrote 6 books on the knowledge he received during his off-planet experiences with extraterrestrials. However, in January 1978, he announced the device was 90% finished, and that he was going to try it himself. 3 months later, he died in suspicious circumstances, apparently of a heart attack. His death came as a surprise for everyone, because Van Tassel was a healthy person, and he did not suffer any symptomatic warnings of an attack. After his death, all of his documents and plans were stolen. Another very interesting case is that of US engineer, Dr. Daniel Fry. According to his statements, Fry witnessed the landing of a UFO on the 4th of July, 1950. He walked toward it and touched it, sensing that he was dealing with something yet unknown on Earth. The surface had the soft texture of soap, and from the craft's interior, a voice of warning emerged: "Best not to touch it, friend. It's still hot. Stay calm, you are among friends." Dr. Fry's principal contact was a being from planet Venus called Alan, whose Venusian name is Valiant Thor. He explained most of the physics involved in the construction and handling of his ship, some of which Fry understood, as he was a highly skilled, expert space technician. In fact, he worked at the White Sands Proving Ground, in New Mexico, in the United States, near where the encounter took place. The visitors were trying to help Earthlings to change the course of events, and warning them of a Holocaust that otherwise seems inevitable, they said. They told Fry that he should write a book to communicate this message to the people of the Earth, which he did, obediently. On a related note, it's very striking that Pope John XXIII had several physical encounters with extraterrestrial beings, one of which was very unique and well documented. It took place at the Pope's summer residence at Castel Gandolfo in 1961, 2 years before his death. One of his attendees recounts details of the July evening in 1961, as follows. While we were walking through the garden, we spotted a ship overhead. It was oval-shaped and its intermittent lights were blue and amber-colored. We are referring to a flying object that flew over the heads of the Roman pontiff and his assistant before it landed on the lawn of the Pope's residence on the southernmost side of the garden. Suddenly, a strange being emerged from the craft's interior. Although very human-looking, he was surrounded by a golden light and had very long ears. Later, the Supreme Pontiff and his assistant got down on their knees, without really understanding what they were seeing. All they knew was that this being was not from this world, and that it had to be a celestial event. After their prayer, they were very surprised to see that the strange man from the stars was still there, which proved he was not a vision. The Holy Father immediately got up and walked towards the mysterious stellar being and they had a conversation for about 15 to 20 minutes. Then, the cosmonaut turned around and headed back to his ship. Without another word, he took off into space. Furthermore, according to the assistant, the Pope never talked to him about this experience. Yet, many times, when the Holy Father went out into the garden, the assistant was certain there were UFOs in the area, since he observed the presence of intermittent lights, which confirmed that the Supreme Pontiff had other contacts with beings from the stars. In fact, some years earlier, in the 1950s, according to the testimony of a highly qualified witnesses, Pope Pius XII also had a related experience. A report written by Cardinal Tedeschini describes the incident. On one occasion, the Supreme Pontiff appeared to be very troubled and excited. I had never seen him like that before, and he confirmed his state. He told me, "Yesterday I saw a wonder that has made a great impression on me. It was October 30, 1950 and I was taking my usual walk in the Vatican Gardens, reading and studying some documents, when I was surprised by a phenomenon unlike any I have ever seen. The sun was still quite high and it appeared to be surrounded by a luminous ring that made it impossible to stare at it at length, without discomfort. The object moved in a circular motion, going from left to right, and vice versa. You could see some movement inside, as if people were coming and going. I tried several times to see the globe again, in similar weather conditions, but had no such luck. It was no use, I could not see it anymore. Through this journey through time, we have examined some interesting cases of sightings of unidentified flying objects and of people contacted by beings of light throughout history, who, in many cases, reached our planet via interdimensional portals from faraway stars and distant galaxies to bring various kinds of knowledge to humanity through the people they contacted. Now, we shall explore a topic that is also directly related to these dimensional portals by looking at several mystifying and mysterious cases of time travel, whose protagonists never imagined they would find themselves involved in temporal anomalies, which led them to live in another space-time in history. We now travel back to a sunny afternoon in July 1996, where we find a police officer from Liverpool visiting Bold Street in the company of his wife. They have to do some shopping, so they walk towards the central station and divide up their errands. Carol has to go to Dylan's bookshop and Frank to a shop in search of a music CD he wants to buy. Everything is totally normal as they cross the center of Liverpool in England. Frank does not realize that something in his surroundings has changed in a heartbeat. A strange oasis of calm engulfs him suddenly. It's as if the world has stood still in less than a second. He doesn't know what is happening. All of a sudden, a small truck that looks like it was manufactured in the 1940s bursts onto the scene. It is speeding towards where Frank is standing, to the point that it nearly runs him over. Our protagonist looks around and sees that something else isn't right. It looks like the same road, Bold Street, but Dylan's bookshop has another sign that reads Cripps. Frank doesn't remember there being a change in ownership, much less with that name. He crosses the street to get closer so that he can look at their window display. There is no sign of books. In their place are women's handbags and shoes. Frank's astonishment continues, and he checks to make sure he is not on the wrong street. But, no, it is undoubtedly Bold Street. Frank starts to look at the passers-by, and notices how the men and women around him look. They are all wearing clothes from the 1940s. It can't be. Suddenly, a woman about 20 years old crosses the street near him. She is wearing a sleeveless lime-colored blouse and carrying a handbag whose brand looks familiar. Frank decides to follow the young woman, who enters what is now a woman's fashion shop called Cripps. They enter the shop at almost the same time, and the pair discover that its interior is entirely changed. There is no sign of the handbags and shoes seen from the outside. Instead, they find the books and manuscripts of Dylan's shop, just as it is in the present. Everything switched faster than the snap of one's fingers. Apparently, space and time had ruptured twice, right under their noses. "Did you see that?" Frank asks the young woman. "Yes," she answers. "I thought this was a clothes shop, and I wanted to take a look inside, but it turns out it's a bookshop." Frank was not crazy. The girl's experience was similar to his own. Out on the street again, there was no trace of the wide roads or clothing typical of the World War II era. These kinds of cases have been happening on the same street in Liverpool over the years, connecting to different periods in time, and it is much more common than we might think. It is as if that exact spot in the world hosts a stable anomaly, a doubling of what we call reality, a rupture in the eternal present in which we live. Without warning, this strange phenomenon warps the dimension of time and connects to different eras in the same place. The fact that this incident involved two different people is very interesting. Are there holes in space and time scattered throughout the earth and sky? Thank you. Without a doubt, this is what we may be led to believe upon observing cases like that of a pilot by the surname of Davies, who, in 1992, took off from a private airfield in Chester, England, whilst piloting a small plane. His aim was to reach Liverpool's Speke Airport, but something else was in store for him during the flight. On his journey, Davies passed through the Stamford Bridge area and noticed something strange. Down below, he should see cars the size of ants circulating on the M53 and M56 highways, and is genuinely surprised. The highways have disappeared. That can't be. Davies checks his control panel and finds no errors. He is in Stamford Bridge, for sure, based on his coordinates and geolocation. Yet, there is no trace of the highways. The pilot looks down and is utterly intrigued. He brings the plane lower to get a look at the area. He wants to see it better. What he sees does not look familiar. Right at that instant, his heart almost leaps out of his chest. It looks like a military squadron. Davies searches the tiny cabin for his binoculars in order to capture more details. There is nothing down there, only fields and low houses, where there should be a city and highways. All he sees is grass, an old road, and that squadron. They seem to be organized like Roman militias. To his right, a building similar to the villas of Julius Caesar's empire. A thick mist, at low altitude, seems to gradually engulf the whole setting and begins to obscure the pilot's visibility. That strange vapor formed very quickly, as if artificially, and was beginning to surround the aircraft. Once Davies leaves the mist behind, he sees the A548 highway, the grey buildings, and the tiny cars. Everything was back to normal after his encounter with a space-time fold, which involved an astonishing journey back to the time of battles between the Bretons and the Romans. The protagonist was convinced he had just flown over an area of Britain occupied by the Roman Empire thousands of years ago. The most interesting thing we can see in this case is that the pilot's view was not shared by the soldiers, who, no doubt, would have been surprised to see a unique mechanical bird flying over their heads. This did not happen, as the witness and his movements were invisible to the eyes of that Roman squadron. This is the vortex phenomenon in its purest form, that is, a single person in a controlled environment, namely, the fog that begins and ends the event. In between, it affords a high-definition view of an environment physically impossible in 1992. England appears to be a land prone to these kinds of incidents, where the past is visible and the future as well. A number of strange events took place between 1995 and 1997, near Runcorn Bridge, also in Liverpool, whereby different people claimed to have seen what looked like a futuristic city, where the city's airport should have been. The best case is that of a man called Frank Jones. On December 5, 1995, he was out walking in the Hale Bank area, which is connected to the airport via the highway. Frank's journey progresses as usual, when suddenly, in less than a tenth of a second, this view is altered. His eyes see what looks like a spaceport, rather than an airport. There are huge lenticular ships with red and blue lights shining on the horizon. Objects fly, take off, and land. Some get lost in the firmament at an immense speed. Frank observes the scene and looks hard at one area inside the port, featuring circular geometry. These floating marvels appear to be taking off from there, and they do so, vertically and without making any noise. There is no way this is the Liverpool Airport in the year 1995. Frank observes more details. The imposing tower-like buildings and Titanic constructions were packed with lively and brilliant colors, and there are a lot of them. These colossal structures broke up the skyline, along with ships that came and went. It was an awe-inspiring sight. He could not believe what he was seeing. It must be an optical illusion, he thought, but it certainly didn't look like one. He continued walking, until he reached Queensway, on the other side of the Mersey River, and momentarily lost sight of the spectacular view, whilst crossing an area of tall vegetation. Everything disappeared, and when he went back to look at the area, it was as if nothing had ever happened. It's just that human beings have a lively imagination, we might think. The problem is that the next day, there were at least three other reports from three different witnesses, mentioned in several local radio programs and in different newspapers in the city of Liverpool, that all told the same story. Is it possible that Mr. Jones accidentally accessed some sort of register that remains recorded, immortalizing humanity's every deed and every construction, no matter the era? The amazing thing is that this phenomenon was seen by several witnesses. In other words, they were in the exact spot in which the phenomenon manifests itself, in the spectrum visible to human eyes. As we conclude this episode on stargates and time travelers, we continue to warn viewers about the sun's intense activity that is taking place in the current solar cycle, number 25. Indeed, powerful solar flares are observed every day, as was the case on November 11, 2023, with AM 1.2 class flare, with a coronal mass ejection that energized the Earth's entire magnetic field. Furthermore, a magnetic filament on the Sun started to erupt on November 16, launching another coronal mass ejection almost directly towards Earth, which generated aurorae borealis at very low latitudes. Moreover, on November 18, there was another M1.2 class solar flare that caused a radio blackout, affecting the South Indian Ocean, opposite the western coast of Australia. The next day, there were M-class solar eruptions, the first, an M1.1, and the other M1.0, which affected South America and the Pacific. And on November 20, a new M1.2 class flare developed on the Sun's surface, causing a radio blackout over Africa and the Indian Ocean. It should also be noted that on November 23, solar activity increased, with a new class M1.5 flare, accompanied by the eruption of three solar filaments. Not long after the flare, a radio blackout occurred, affecting the northeastern coast of Australia. On that day, November 23, two new flares, both of which were M1.1 class, took place on the Sun, which caused radio blackouts in South America and in the Mozambique Channel, in South Africa. On November 29, there was a powerful M9.8 class flare, in other words, it almost reached the X-class flare level, which sent a coronal mass ejection directly to Earth. This flare followed another, which was also M3.4 class, and both affected an area on the west coast of South America. Furthermore, on December 1, right before the publication of this video documentary, a new M1.1 class flare caused a radio blackout that affected the west coast of Australia. With these last flares, it should be noted that in the last 20 days, from the 11th of November to the 1st of December, there have been 11 strong Class M solar flares, which demonstrates that the Sun's activity continues to be on the rise.